Yeah, okay. So in this day, I'm going through writings and I'm like, well, yeah, it's a decadent indulgence to put the pen to paper again and again. And sometimes, I guess it's an egomatic, what is it, an heirloom from the family, you know, brought down through the centuries, because I know my grandfather was that way, my mother was that way. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't think anybody even buys books anymore. So, and, you know, it has to have like three words, maybe. Three words. And maybe they can understand, you know. So like, as a marketability, it's like, so the indulgent writer, the one who is just you know, making Thoreauisms, they're just waste. It's just waste, isn't it? It's becoming waste into the fashion. There is no fashion time for it, is there? There's no fashion time. It's a waste. We don't have the indulgent factor of longevity in the read, you know. It's, you know, he did this, she did that. It's almost like, you know, that's perhaps, you know, in the person factor, you know, just the facts, just straight up facts, you know, again and again. And I was like, okay, well it's kind of, I don't know, kind of sad. It's kind of sad because, but then it isn't, because you already know the decadence. You already know the decadence on the pen that just keeps writing and writing and writing and writing. They had the time. They had all the time in the world, you know. So remember, they didn't have television. They didn't have, you know, formal entertainment. Oh, but that's not true. That's not true. I actually found out today. What was I saying? Oh, one of these guys, one of my, I don't know, ancestor dudes. I'm not going to get too hypey for him because, my gosh, apparently I read here he had a whole bunch of slaves. So I'm not going to tell you the number, but he abandoned them and left. But the deal was he erected an opera house in Atlanta, Georgia. So that's kind of cool. So I have one dude who, you know, put up an opera house to cheer and uplift spirits through the hovering gray cloud of civil war. Okay, now, am I even allowed? I mean, are we even allowed to read something that goes on that long and it says, you know, to cheer and uplift spirits through the hovering cloud gray of civil war? I just don't believe so. I don't believe this is even possible anymore. This is such a frantic society, a frantic pace of commercialism. I don't believe so, no. Yeah, and I even left out an inn in there, but oh my gosh, yeah, that is so cool. The first opera house in Atlanta, you know, had a whole bunch of slaves though, so he'll only be bastardized for that, you know, forever, and that's the way it goes. So the deal is, what is the deal? Oh my gosh, he planted the first tobacco plantation in North Carolina. Oh my goodness, let's have some cigarettes. Now that would be where Thomas Jefferson took tea. That is so cute of him. Yeah, that was an upshot. John Vance, he's called. And he was, he lusted after agricultural riches in colonial America. So he became an export tobacco magnet. Isn't that cute? Yeah. So anyway. Oh, I did read something that was really kind of interesting about once they did get to Mexico. I swear, something must be in the food there. But then I'm like, no, it's just an overdone, luxuriant line that just had the time to just be, you know, you've seen them. You've been to England, and you've seen those massive, massive chateaus, and they just hang out there in their massive chateaus, and they own it, and they're, well, is it an insanity line? Maybe they're all. I mean, maybe all aristocrats at some point are, you know, dealing with that much time on their hands, that much dominion. So here we go. Oh my gosh, I have voluptuous, you know, and so I have to read this from my mother, you know, voluptuous Theresa Margaret of Bally Castle. I guess so. Irish. She was an Irish duchess. Now she apparently. Oh my gosh, stolen. He stole her. So one of my old whatever ancestors, Teresa was stolen. Isn't that cute? Just thieved while she was plucking wisteria blossoms. Now she, there were. That's excellent. Now, wisteria blossoms. It says by the shores of the North Channel, but for some reason, by the shores of was crossed out. So that's not clarified yet, and maybe never will be because this is old heritage. This is old history. And who cares? Who cares, right? We know. Yeah, she was kicking and screaming as he held her tightly by her red hair and pink satin, and they sailed up the Sound Jura to the T.M. Ribbon, Flying Ribbons, whatever that is, to the White Cliffs of Fort William. So there they went, swooping her up in his arms. Oh my gosh, this is so romance novel, this direction, yeah, swooping her up. He held her tightly by her prodigious red hair, yeah, swirling with blossoms and tangling in his royal fingers. The black stallion arrogantly snorting, galloping boldly through the rolling green hills of Scotland. There it is again, Teresa's pink satin ribbons flying in the winds. Yeah, North Island, Ireland to the sailing ship. All right. So anyway, I have all this. All of a sudden, is new. Apparently, one of the relatives. Oh my gosh, this is Richard Snow. There he is. Always bragged of his blue blood ancestry. Proud to be a descendant of the illustrious Anglo-Saxon lineage. Now. He delved through the pages of his genealogy as if it were the current telephone directory, okay? His favorite relative of the relatives was Eric the Red. Isn't that cute? Eric the Red, the rebel with a cause, who burned down the first Vatican in ancient Rome. Now, I didn't even know that until today. Now, I was about to throw this paper away, and I'm like, oh my gosh, that is terrible. Apparently, Eric the Red was there burning down the Vatican in ancient Rome, and he's in my bloodline. Isn't that sweet? That is so cool, in a way. I love that. That is absolutely excellent. So I'm a marauder. I'm a marauder who just damned Catholicism. That is excellent. I really needed that today. All right, so what else do I have? What else do I have? I know there's both sides and everything, but you got to get a good marauder in there ever so often. Oh my gosh. So here we have Richard Snow here. Revered his, blah, 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 blah. Did I already read that part? Oh, no. Revered his royal blood type A negative. Now we already know now he's an A negative. Inherited from Sir Duke William Vaux of Scotland. Now, for some reason, I don't know how this is known, but he's a blood type A. All right. Who manned his Baumbach castle with 40 knights at the Myrtlewood round table. So there was a Baumbach castle. I don't even know if it's still there standing. I haven't visited it. But there, it has a myrtlewood round table, and there were 40 knights there. So it sounds a little bit, I don't know, mimicky of Sir Arthur, or maybe that was just the way it was going on at the time. Everybody had to have their round table. Okay, so now we have, and that was Duke, Sir Duke William Vaux. Okay, now we have Lord Master William. Lord Master William not only enjoyed the rigors of the fox hunt, but he had a roving eye for feisty foreign maidens as well. Oh my God! I mean, how do I... oh my gosh, are you kidding me? That is ridiculous. Feisty foreign maidens. He wanted them feisty. Now that's unusual. That's unusual in this world now. It seems like every woman has to be tame, extraordinarily tamed, or else. So anyway, yeah, that's fun. Maybe that's a game. That's a game of the aristocrats used to be able to indulge in, as even feisty itself. Yeah, maybe that's a sadness with common. Feisty can't happen. So, well, anyway, so he was the one, Lord William, who stole this cutesy little voluptuous Irish duchess, Miss Theresa Margaret of Bally Castle. So there we are. Now, wisteria blossoms, I'm not really sure. Gosh dang it, no color. I didn't get the color out. But this is translated down from, you know, through my grandfather. So that's kind of cool. That's kind of cool. Oh my gosh, I love finding this information. So this sounded like it was a really good hype across, and to get, and then they got went across the, you know, eventually they went across to this tobacco business, and somehow along the way there was John Vance, you know, with the V-A-N-S name. Now somehow with that, there must have been a child. He must have been a child from her, but I don't know how it all works out, because this is more of a, you know, this is more of a romance novel, the way my mother was trying to write it, quoted out from my grandfather. But I did read, though, which was really, really fun, before before Vance, Alabama, and all of that, information. I was reading, where was it? Oh my gosh, I mean, just endless time. They had endless time. Now, we were talking about, oh, here it is, the downfall of the royal heritage. Now, apparently there was a downfall time, and it was Robert E. Vance who did this. He severed the gloried Anglo line of blue blood. He was cut off from the family, from their fame, from their fortune, when he left his slaves to fare for themselves in the cotton fields. So when that went on, that was it. For some reason, he was royally cut off. And he was disowned when he left his brother Albert alone to fight the bloody Yankees, it says here. So he left his little brother, I don't know, it could have been his big brother, but Albert. And I guess what? It's been a flogging ever since in my family. Yeah. So who's the flogging coming from? Is it coming from England? You know, the abandoned? Apparently there were 1,000 slaves. Is the flogging from what? And the 1,000 were not necessarily at that particular moment in time, but I wrote it. I didn't write it, no. It was written in here somewhere. You know, and I'm like, God dang it, that's a big number to just quote out there. I have to be, you know, a little more sure of it. You know, and I'm like, well, I guess they're the Vances of Vance, Alabama. What more can I say? Okay, so... Anyway, so the renegade Robert, who just dropped the turkey and decided to leave them in the cotton fields, renegade Robert hightailed it to Mexico, and he was chasing a woman searching for love. Okay, so in the remote mountainous territory of Chihuahua, he founded his own divine reality. So he got his own ranch there, a huge ranch. And he raised Brahma bulls of sacred Shiva strain, and breeding Arabian race horses sired by champion Omar Khayyam, satisfied his desire for respect and notoriety in Latin America. So he raised Brahma bulls and Arabian horses. So he must have left with some kind of money because he had a 10,000-acre ranch at that time. Being an educated man of doctoral letters, he introduced the first numerical symbols, Arabic, to the primitive inhabitants of Chuachupa. So also, I guess the numbers Arabic numeral system was important for him to give off to them. The learning of numbers was necessary to keep count of his numerous hybrid stock, livestock. Reynaldo El Red, a Tarahumara half breed, quickly adapted to the number system of 0 to 5,000, and kept cautious count of Don Roberto's prize-winning bulls and Arabic racers. Okay, so the gray silver Brahmas and the white Omar stallions, menacingly wild and unbroken, were especially in demand by Argentine gauchos, the fiercest and fastest bareback riders of La Pampa. That's what the way they were raising there. Gray silver Brahmas and white Omar stallions. Don Robert, more a Brahmin at heart than a cowpoke riding Brahma, always took time out to engage in patrician culture. Being a high-toned aficionado of the classics, he coached the indigenous Chuachupas in Shakespearean sonnets, and he taught them to play Mozart melodies on the harpsichord. Again, Reynaldo El Red took the spotlight, and what did he do? And he seemed to be particularly endowed with musical talent. All right, producing scenes, 12-string guitar, sounds struck on a chord, some with a flute. There's some kind of a wind flute there. But yeah, that's exciting. So they were raising these amazing stallions and these gray-silver Brahmas. And he brought Arabic and Shakespearean sonnets to the people, as well as not Arabic sonnets, but Arabic numeric system. And yeah, it was apparently cut off at that time from the line of blue bloods. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Was it the deal with the finality of abandoning slavery altogether, and him making that choice? And, you know, that's it. The war's over. So who was really backing the war? England itself? It seems so. So here we are with his music-loving Aboriginal compadres, nightly retreats around a campfire. Gosh, it must have been a strange exodus all of a sudden, for sure. Reminiscent in his past Beaumont life of the South, with fond memory, he pictured the graceful Grecian white columns of his rambling plantation home. The southern air, always heavy sweet, scented with showy white magnolia blossoms. Oh, they were white French magnolia blossoms. So that's a difference. There's a white French one. All right. And though it did say imported from France, but that's been crossed out. So they were not imported. They're just white French ones. Okay, he, as a silk stocking in those days, when he waltzed elegantly, swirling Miss Sarah in triple time on the spacious outdoor veranda. Each whirl caught the delicate whiffs of Florida citrus orange and lemon. Oh my goodness, what does that say? In the warm summer breezes? Yeah. The perfumed Persian jasmine. Now, where am I here? Reeking of a rot. I'm sorry, my eyes are just sporadic all over. The perfumed Persian jasmine, reeking of exotic white and yellow flowers, always took her breath away, especially in the lunges, the deep lunges of the forbidden dance, the tango. So for some reason, they're talking about silk stocking and some swirling Mrs. Sarah. And can anybody even follow this? I don't know. Robert had boldly introduced the tango to his creme de la creme circle of friends upon his return from a castle. A cattle. Oh my gosh, what a switch. Castles to cattle? I mean, just awful. All right. And everything else, you know, the plundering of and having the slaves and all of that. Just, you know, what a terrible, terrible journey. I don't know. I just don't like colonialism at all. I think it was a horrible invention that had it. Did it have to happen? I mean, I guess so. I guess to get from A to B to C here, I mean, I guess it was always going to happen. I guess there was always going to be an undergroup that was grabbed, snagged, and taken advantage of. That's just, yeah. I mean, that's unfortunately the way it goes. Is history has had an undergroup that has been enslaved in some way, whether it's men or women, ethnic or whatever. So I mean, I know that go on and on here in the United States about slavery, but it happened all over. It happened all over the world. Huge amounts went on Africa to South America, much larger than happened to here to the United States. I mean, from Africa to the United States, many more ships. And then there was always going from Africa to Northern Europe, Africa to Europe, Lower Europe, all over the place. So I don't know. I they're pretty heavy here in America on it, and I'm not really sure why. Because the blacks are in Europe also. And they didn't seem to get the same type of history hurt. It's almost like they've delivered a history hurt here. Extra. And I'm not really sure why that was necessary. Alright, so anyway. Oh my gosh. The Argentine tango. So now I don't see. You see how they are? I mean, they just. This is the problem. I you know. Now they're going off on the Argentine tango, and I really just wanted to talk about the Omar Stallions, and I wanted to talk about the Brahmas that they had. Gosh dang it. In a way, it's so sad because I prefer more information about one little topic. And yet this is paraphrased even, you know, and I'm like, well, do people even have time? No, you know, it has to be so paraphrased, doesn't it? It has to be so cliff notes. Everything is a cliff note. And even less. All right, so there you are. The Argentine tango always made his Miss Sarah blush demure, her eyelashes long, silky black. Each one to reveal the sparkle of her alluring green eyes. So it was a Sarah with green eyes. A suggestive invitation. As a fragile tear descended rhythmically, serenely to her warm and rosy cheekbone. her affected gay laughter, light like the tinkling bells of her golden charm bracelet. In provocative, oh, I can't read this one, sorry. In provocative breaths escaping from her moist cherry lips. So somewhere there's a golden charm bracelet. Anyway, that's the way this family is. It's just like sifting through a haystack. Aroused, Don Roberto, just to think of it now. He and Sarah were the talk of the town in those days and fancied by local gentries as being the Venus and Adonis of Vance, Alabama. So they were the Venus and Adonis. Anyway, so that was, yeah, ridiculous. The jovial slap on the knee. You see how they are? I mean, and meanwhile, you already know all of this is going on. There's just, you know, they're out there in the cotton fields. So the jovial slap on the knee by L. Red could barely jar his consciousness to sitting on a wilderness carpet of pine needles among his Tarahumara compadres. So now they've flipped out. They've gone back from Alabama. See, this is the problem. They've gone back to the mountains again. El Coyote whipping raw hide on a Monterey stump. And sometimes I just hate that. I hate the switch. I hate the switch, the tone switch in the voice, so that I have to say El Coyote. I hate that. I hate that about my family, in a way. I hate that, like, sort of, a little bit Spanish, all of a sudden, accent. Anyway, the horses were stirring nervously, snorting impatiently, and smelling of wet hay. There was a distant howl of Kicha, the lone gray she-wolf. And so now I'm like, well, and now you're saying, well, this is fantasial, but it's not. There were wolves, and I imagine they did name the wolf. And I imagine they knew it was a she-wolf. So this is all, like, not even debatable. This is actually a true story. And it's just like, well, crud. Now there's Kicha, the lone gray she-wolf. And the bolsterous comadre untamed, hooting out tempos with a primitive urgency, seemed all too fantastic, almost imaginary. I mean, and then I'm thinking about ballet, you know, and people on stage, and you know, do you even have time to watch, you know? And it's just, it's so disheartening. It's so disheartening. All right, so here I'm at this squeaky desk that I made. It's my desk is perched on paint cans. And it's kind of a funny fall out of Vance, Alabama, isn't it? My God. So anyway, with nostalgic, bittersweet longing, Don Roberto recalled the stateliness of eminent guests, noble guests, who guested regularly to his lordly Alabama home. So now we're flipping back to Alabama again. All right, unforgetful. He forgot the grandiose entertainment of such smashing artists as concert pianist Wilbur Van Cleve, whose gifted fingers scaled the ivory keys of the splendid black ebony grand, filling the majestic ballroom with sonorous sonatinas of four movements by Schubert. His increasing crescendos and lively allegros left us Austrian chandeliers vibrating and prism colors dancing on crystal window panes. So there is this famous pianist now in the Alabama home, I guess this is what they're trying to say, of Wilbur Van Cleve, and he's giving the concert, and it's a Schubert, and it's movement number 4, and they have Austrian chandeliers there. So now we're delving into capricious play. Van Cleve titillated his audience to peak capacity with Mozart's resque, allegros, resque. Now that I haven't heard as a term in a long time. I actually have to look that up, sorry. Allegretos, bordering on dulcet indelicacies. So it's possible there's a hint there with dulcet indelicacies. So maybe that's resque, might be that. It's R-E-S-Q-U-E apostrophe. So slowing to andante. Genius Cleve worked the ivories with Chopin's tuneful euphonies, gloomy and pensive. Don Roberto's Don Roberto's Dionysian reverie ended. Oh gosh, that word. I've seen it like maybe, I don't know, 200 times, but I still can't say it. Dionysian. Okay. Don Roberto's Dionysian reverie ended on the elusive, melancholic tone of Chopin. Savoring mint juleps with a mint of orange and, I don't know, orange and something else. Served by well-mannered, polite, and here it is, the word, black slaves, was alive. It's impossible, you know, I have to hold my breath and have a heart attack reading that. I mean, that's ridiculous. That's the past. Okay, was a life he'd never have again. Okay, so there he is, savoring mint juleps, served by his polite help, and a life he'd never have again. It was a life he would never have again. So for some reason, it's kind of like an ending. It's an ending before. It's an ending before everything, you know, the move away. But yeah, so I guess that dude was there playing the piano. That's interesting. Wilbur Van Cleve. I don't know. So here's Robert E. Now, he never reconciled with his Southern Vance family of European aristocracy. He was a black sheep, ostracized from his own kind. He lived out a harsh life as a cultured rancher in the craggy pinnacles of Chihuahua's Sierra Madres, isolated with his immediate family and befriended by native Indians, and frequently raided by Mexican revolutionist hero Pancho Villa. But he had Mary, his wife, for whom he had thrown his inheritance to dust in the hostile Madres. He had been mesmerized by her tough pioneer spirit and stick-to-itiveness as compared to the sensitive flower bellies of the South. Oh no, not flower bellies, flower bells. Flower bells of the South, who wept coyly who wept coyly when Swain wooed them into submission. Yeah. Swain suave swooed. All right, okay. So apparently there's good breeding, cavalier, dashing, valiant, and chivalrous all going on here. A moment. We have fleeing from social injustice in Coventry Garden still going on. Not in Coventry Garden, in Coventry, England. They're fleeing there. Mary's family had sailed to America. And because the first to... the first to practice religious freedom on Plymouth Rock, pure and simple. Okay, so her Puritan relatives sought no political aspirations, no wealth of tobacco fields or slave ownership. They instituted the Puritan work ethic with steadfast tenacity, coveted two common goals, work and pray. And when it came to faith in her religion, Mary stuck to her guns, but Robert didn't feel quite as faithful. Having descended from Eric the Red, the rebel who torched the Vatican, she was afflicted with that thorn in her side each time she trimmed her rose bushes. So apparently she was something. I don't know what they're going on about now. Oh my gosh. Yeah, something about rose bushes. This is nothing to do with the rose bush itself. She stuck to her guns, basically, and he didn't. That's what's going on. All right. It's not known at all that Robert might have sacrificed for the love of Mary. It is not known... No, what is it? It is not known all that Robert might have sacrificed for the love of Mary. As it turned out, she wasn't very affectionate. She was a small woman who carried a big hoe and sharp pruning shears. All right. Besides, she certainly wasn't a special butterfly and refused to mix with the brown-skinned indigenous people of Mexico. So that was... Now, she was from Coventry, England. That's all I know. I think that was Mary Wren. But I'm not certain on that one. Flabbergasted. Oh my gosh, I don't even think these are in order. Maybe that's another problem. Maybe there's a problem in the family line. I can get things in order. I don't understand why they couldn't get things in order. Oh my gosh, they go on and on, you know. Flabbergasted. Falcons fell off perches. And what is this? Buffaloed birds. Oh my god. No. It's all important, isn't it? You know. Panicked. People ran for cover. Flabbergasted. Falcons fell off perches. Dumbfounded. Deer. Buffaloed. Birds stopped chirping. Oh my god. Is this a strange poem? What's the deal? Dazed. Does staggered in a mid-leap. Oh my god. I have no idea how this one came out. But this is a what? A quagmired quail sat stunned. Scared. Stood still. Crows. Cawed no more. Oh my god. I mean, what would we do without these words? You know, it's like my family keeps these words for the rest of the world, you know, who forgot them. It's ridiculous. Okay, so here they are, cawing no more. Ridiculous. I have not even heard the word caw in so long. You know? That's amazing. So, what is the next thing? Oh my gosh. I can't say this one. Cowed. There is a word called cowed. C-O-W-E-D. Cougars. Cowed cougars quit yowling. This is some kind of a tongue twister that I'm reading all of a sudden. Cowed cougars quit yowling. Alarmed avalanches ceased sliding. Everything within the echoing distance of scat became an interloper haunted with fear of Mary's final sequel. This is the problem. What are they doing there? Get, it says, okay, not even a rabbit set paw in that sacred pansy patch. Not even a rabbit. Now, all of a sudden, this is all about a pansy patch. And so I have to go through all of this to deal with it. This is a woman just guarding her pansy patch that we're talking about. I think so. I mean, this has nothing to do with what I was reading before. And so this is the problem with the history. All right. Poor Robert. Okay, poor Robert. He didn't know what he saw in Mary in the first place. Now he was stuck with 5,000 head of cattle and 10 kids. I mean, maybe she just went insane having 10 children. That's enough to make any woman go crazy. I mean, could they just stop? I mean, did they not get it? You know, they procreate every time they do that, they have one. Why couldn't they just lay off and just, like, give her, like, a year or something? Okay, anyway, prayerful. Prayerful Mary wasn't much help either. So anyway, so there he is, and he's stuck with 5,000 head of cattle and these 10 kids, and her just freaking out in her pansy patch. All right, so anyway, so she pretty well kept to the shrinking violets and the sun-kissed satiny petals of the gladiolas. What is the deal now? I mean, it's just... Okay, well, anyway, no, she's a gardener. This is just a woman in her flower garden. She's not insane. I'm not trying to push that one. She's just a woman in her flower garden. Okay, so she kept well to the shrinking violets and the sun-kissed satiny petals of the gladiolas, hoeing meticulously at their delicate root systems daily. Meanwhile, Robert was hounded by 10 kids, following him around day and night, asking stupid questions like, who am I? And what must I become? To be or not to be? That was always the question. The Vance kids seemed to have an identity problem. They didn't know whether or not to be Mexican. They didn't know how to be American. Finally, the youngest, George, got so confused that his little brain simply went up in smoke. His naive mother wasn't the least bit concerned. She said he'd outgrow it, you know, that's all. His naive mother wasn't that concerned at all. His brain was gone. He'd outgrow it in time, just like her, oh my gosh. He'd outgrow it in time, just like her flowers always did. Okay, when the hydrology distribution was circumvented. Where did that come from? Okay, well, that didn't happen. I mean, why is hydrology in there all of a sudden? Just to confuse me? Okay, 40 years later, in the trunk of the 46th Plymouth, he was smuggled across the border into Texas, and no one ever heard of him again. That's all we know. So Robert and Mary blamed each other for George's sudden disappearance and decided their marriage had been a mistake. Don Roberto saddled up midnight his Champ Omar stud and rode off at high noon into the back country to live with White Dove, a Matizo squaw. So what happened? Don Roberto ended up with a Matizo squaw. Mestizo squaw. And he went away on his Omar stallion named White Dove. His Mestizo squaw is named White Dove. Oh my gosh. So somewhere there's a line stemming from White Dove. Okay, so we have Robert, but this is just the Vances I'm talking about. I'm not talking about anybody else. I'm not talking about the illustrious Fontaines. All right, so, yada yada. So anyway, so now Mary abandoned there. Her husband just left her after all those 10 children. And he left on midnight. That was the name of his Omar stud. And, apparently after that, Mary was frigid. It says, frigid Mary was glad. She was happy to get rid of the dude. And so he did nothing but bring about hysteria in her pansy population. So, he did nothing but cause disturbances or motor functions in the delicate root systems of her high-bred rose zone. Good riddance, she hummed, while hoeing at her domesticated violet society. Hallelujah, she tittered, while pruning the prickly stems bearing sweet-smelling purplish rosebuds. So she was happy to just be left alone in her little flower garden. All the while, Robert and Mary were taming the wilds in vain. Little Richard Snow ran barefoot and free with white-tailed deer and white, wild-spirited Tarahumaras, that's an Indian tribe. He grew to become one with the animals, regarded humans to be less than dependable, and abandoned the family homestead for happiness in the ponderosa pines of El Gato Durango. His brothers squandered the Shiva Brahmas and the Omar Kayams on luckless gambling, tainted women, and bad liquor. So apparently the Brahmas and the Omar stallion racers were gambled out. Okay, so his sisters married indigent passerbys, scrubby, illiterate miners grubbing for gold in the rocks, creeks, and crevices of the Sierra Madres. So his sisters married gold miner grubbiers. Okay, only his sister Mabel Clare escaped a life of squalor. One day, while dreaming about Louis the 14th Versailles and Baroque ballet on the boughs of a spreading maple tree, she spied a wealthy Englishman surveying lumber prospects. It was Cooper, pursuing a foreign investment dream masterminded by his father, who with his family sank to the bottom of the Bering Sea on the historical Titanic. So apparently, he was a loner after his family had sunk out. So then there she was, Mabel's keen instinct, raw and refined, striking like lightning. Unsuspected, pounced on the lone Cooper survivor, because he was a lone survivor, and ravished him with irresistible wild berry kisses. The smitten, pink-cheeked, and robust, this is 48 minutes long, Jesus Christ, okay, robust C.H. whisked her away on his Ferroseri Union Occidental aboard a Pullman plush pillowed in satin brocade and goose down. Okay, so apparently they were on a Pullman on the Union Occidental train station there, and satin brocade and goose down. And as it was bound to happen, they lived unpretentiously on a mountainous estate in the boom town founded of El Salto, Durango. So So Mabel, who acquired wealth, she traced her Vance ancestry. Because if you don't acquire wealth, you can't trace your ancestry. So she traced her Vance ancestry back before Christ, apparently, and not even... And as much as she dug in the Vance family graveyard in Alabama, she actually did go to Alabama and dug up the graves a little bit. Like, literally, I guess that was a need or a necessity. I'm not really sure why she would have to be there digging. That seems a little raw. But anyway, not even Mabel could get Uncle Albert of Catholic faith to bury the hatchet and allow her an illustrious Vance plot. So apparently this Uncle Albert was really, really, he was the one that was stuck there with the cotton fields and the slaves, and apparently they just were not ever gonna, you know, what do they call that? It's like a grudge. I guess it's a family grudge deal. Not ever stop the grudge. So as a result, she chose to never be buried and forever lies in state above ground. So Mabel, in her well, what do you call that? They weren't gonna allow her back into the family. So that's why she's lying. She didn't get a Vance plot. She wanted a Vance plot. And so because she didn't get it, she lies above the ground somewhere. Anyway, in one of those cemeteries. Richard Snow's proud William Vaux of Scotland offshoot had come to nothing but dust in the wind, rooted in no land. All this for the love of one, that was Mary Wren of Coventry. A comely Puritan who planted posies on foreign soil where they didn't belong. Ultimately, the Johnny-come-latelys deserted the Chuachupas Shangri-La and turned their backs on the fertile ridges of Chihuahua's sierras. Naturally, the natives resumed tooting their hand-carved aboriginal flutes, and the stout-hearted sunflowers uprooted the faint-hearted marigolds. So after she even had her little garden, it looks like it was over. They came in and they just planted sunflowers. Is that what it was all about? So her little garden's gone, and then I'm not really sure how that all happens. And apparently there is, according to this, there's a white dove offshoot somewhere. I'm not sure if they had any children. A mestizo squaw. Now, he had already had 10 children, so I don't know. These men can go on with their fertility, can't they? It's ridiculous. How come they can go? There was that one guy. I know it. It's just ridiculous, this video. But I'm gonna keep. I mean, this is drama of history, you know?